Knowing Rituals. This is a Staging Citizenship lecture by me, Andrew Thomas, at Østfold University College, which I would like my students to watch before Thursday, the 18th of February, 2021. So we talked last week about different kinds of rituals and how you can't really say one thing about all of them. So today we're going to look particularly at certain kinds of rituals, which is to say those rituals which have a particular relationship to knowledge. So we're going to look at things like defining rituals and the kind of rituals that fasten our knowledge to our reality or to the people that we live our lives with. And as such, it's not going to necessarily refer to all rituals, but it's one aspect you can investigate when you are interpreting rituals to find out whether they have this relationship to knowledge. So, as the great philosopher Taylor Swift once said, words can break someone into a million pieces, but they can also put them back together. And what I take her to mean by that is that we can be skeptical, we can use philosophy to be skeptical about the way our words refer, but we can also use our words to establish and to agree on certain definitions. You hear a lot of recent philosophers talking about the word using the word constituting to talk about the way ideas and words and things hang together. And it's true, they're right to do so, to the extent that our words and the way we refer to things hang together with the way we with the way we identify things in the world. It's not that you have a word for something and thereby it exists, but it's more the case that if you're going to have a word for something, you also have to be able to carve up the world in that particular way. You're not going to learn words for color unless you've seen the difference between the different stages in the electromagnetic spectrum. You're not going to be able to learn words like petal and stamen until you've understood that flowers are made of different parts and are not simply a whole. And it's not to say that one of these comes first and the other one comes afterwards. It's just that they all hang together. So our forms of life and our definitions and our understanding of the world, they are related to each other. And it's true to say that certain rituals make these processes, make this context easier. They kind of are oil on the wheels of understanding the world and defining the world. And obviously that's most obviously the case with such naming rituals as I name this ship Boaty McBoatface, or I name this child Andrew Thomas, or I pronounce you man wife, which obviously is something that something has a legal status, which we'll come back to, but it's also a way of saying from now on you can call these people this and this. And that's why certainly in the British tradition it's very normal in the party afterwards for the husband and the wife to use these words. And when they use these words for the first time, this is an old tradition, there's a big hooray because they're using these definitions. So rituals do actually allow us to use a particular language. That's the whole point. So constituting. But like I say, they also have a legal function. You're not allowed to use these words in particular ways unless these words reflect a legal, a law-based phenomenon, unless they're actually of a particular status that has been achieved. And the marriage license, for example, is connected to the legal function and the contract that is written between the marrying partners. And of course, there are lots and lots of legal rituals that we'll probably look at in class. And legal rituals are a subdivision of rituals, just like we've got legal rituals and maybe educational rituals and religious rituals. And although it's tempting to just say, okay, but they're all that's all they don't have anything to do with each other. It's not obvious that in, for example, antiquity or in other cultures, there is such a sharp division between religion and law as we would want to have now. We don't really want religion within law because we don't want any religious-based discrimination in the courtroom. Whereas if we'd looked at the legal definitions and the legal practices of the Roman Empire, for example, they would have been there would have been a continuum between between legal functions and religious functions, and it wouldn't be quite such an obvious division to make. And whilst it's important to keep some divisions loose, some definitions really loose when we're talking about science, for example, what is there to define a man or a woman? If we're going to operate a legal framework, definitions are really central to the whole thing. We can have the luxury of saying, well, it doesn't matter whether you're a man or a woman or old or young, but if you're going to decide whether decide what has happened, then the laws that we have are related to particular stories about history, and those particular stories have to be tested by a jury. And the whole function of a jury and a judge is to decide whether we can apply this particular law to this particular phenomenon or history, and whether the truth telling, whether the story that's being told about it is honest, is sincere, has been true. So while science and social practices have the luxury of a loose relationship to definitions, the rule of law has to be essentialist in some way, for good and ill. Now, in addition to the definitions and the legal processes, rituals very often have a relationship to documentation. And we talked in the lesson last week about the way certain rituals have been replaced by documentation processes, such as the avalanche of written statistics, and national statistics and registrars and so on. Many rituals still go together with documentation, and that's why certain rituals involve handing over a particular kind of documentation, like in particular forms of graduation, at the end of your university time. Very often you will have, and people will take pictures of you with your diploma, in your hand. That's not an axe, that's a diploma, in a way. Similarly, marriage certificates and baptism certificates are handed over in the course of the ritual. And similarly, if you there are other forms of linkage. It's not always the same. It's not that this ritual handing over of the documentation like there is in graduation. For example, if you say the oath to this flag, then you're allowed to receive this kind of document or something very much like it. The point is, there are certain knowledge effects to a lot of rituals, and you can identify those knowledge effects and whether they go together with pieces of paper and declarations. In short, rituals and the right kind of movements that we decide, and which are ingrained in right rituals, they allow us to stop bumping into each other and bumping into things in the world, because we are a thing in the world, and we have to deal with things and people and other people who are things in the world. We're all phenomena, and we're swirling around one another. And definitions divide up things from another, and they divide up people who need definitions and make definitions from the definitions they make, from signifiers and from knowers. So in many ways, we could say that rituals, because of these knowledge effects, they lend a choreography to our lives. So when we look at rituals, we can't say that they all have the same knowledge effects, but we can usually identify three interlocking, or we can very often identify three interlocking processes: constituting, which is say like defining and using words, legal processes like fastening our worlds to the stories and the things that go on in the world, and documentation and knowledge effects. And these three things you can use to analyze the rituals that you might want to look at, and you might want to take part in, and we'll maybe practice this kind of analysis in classroom. I'm looking forward to seeing you again soon.